Sample Editor, Part 1. So we're going to talk about the Sample Editor as part of Editing Basics. And one of the reasons we do that is because you can do a number of fundamental things to your audio there which are hard to do in other places. So you can open the Sample Editor a couple different ways. You can click on the tab here, or you can just double-click on an audio file, and that brings it up. We could also actually go through here and make it full screen, which is what I'm going to do so we can really explore some of these and do so in a kind of efficient way on the screen. So this is a representation of the file on the Arrange window. It actually shows us everything that's inside the file, even if there are handles on either side of the actual region on the Arrange window. And it used to be that this is the only place you could edit down to the actual sample level. And let's zoom in so you can see that. Right down into the sample level here. And this is kind of one way to look at this, but I'm going to show you one other way to see the data here, and that's Show a Sample and Hold, which actually shows you each of the different steps of your audio. So let's go find a place that there's a nice spike. Zoom out for a minute. And, okay. And we should be able to see it here. Right on this point, we'll look at this. Okay, you can see all the little stair steps here. This is actually an individual sample. So if our sampling rate, one of the basic project settings, is 44,100 hertz, that means that there's 44,100 little steps per second. So if you were to count out 44,000 of these things, you would be almost at 1 second a time. So this is kind of a unique way to look at the data here in these little stair steps. And that's the smallest thing we can actually select at any given time. We can't go smaller than that. So pretty interesting. Okay, so there's that. And if we turn all that off, we're actually going to see it all smoothed out. That's just a graphical smoothing, so it looks more like a waveform or what you're used to seeing. So it used to be that you couldn't actually go down to that level in the actual range window, but now you can, and so you can do a lot of editing down to that level in the range window, but this is a place where we can do some additional editing. First of all, the thing you should do before you do anything else is come here and say Create Backup. And this says you want to create a backup, say yes. And the reason we do that is because the sample editor, for the most part, is a destructive editor. That means when I change something, it changes the original file that's on the hard drive. So you gotta be really careful that what you do in here, you have some way to get back to the original, either by doing a new file, or in this case, creating a backup. And one quirk of logic is if you have a really long name, something with a lot of numbers and digits, you can't actually create a backup without changing the name first. That's just a side note. Okay, so once we do that, let's go through some of these menus that we have here. We can do Create Backup. We can revert to it here. So if we make a change we don't like or we just mess things up, we can revert to that. We can save a copy as, and that's a way we can save it into a new file. We can detect transients just to see where those are. We can update file information and refresh overview. So if for some reason something you did isn't showing up in the overview, you can update it right there. Under Edit, we can undo change selection, so we can undo things that we do here in that sense, but once you get past your undo history, you can't go back. That's where the destructive part comes in. We can also see the undo history, and we can do all our normal copy-paste things, our selecting. We can change our region to the selection, etc., and we can also use some of these keyboard shortcuts to navigate through, and snap edits to zero crossings. This is where you select that for here. That means anytime you make an edit, it's going to make sure that the edit point locks to a place where the waveform crosses this zero point. That way, if you do an edit in one place and cut it to another one, they both are crossing a zero, so you're going to have a lot less clicks and pops due to waveforms being cut off in the middle of its actual arch or trough. So that's something you should always probably do, because otherwise you're going to have to do a crossfade between the two to make a match, which is fine as well. So functions, and we'll get to some of these now, and we'll get to some of them in the next part two, because there's a number of things here we should talk about. To use these, we have to make a selection. We can normalize, which means it's going to take it all the way up to zero, so the peak will max out. It won't actually clip, it'll just be taken to the max. We can undo normalize. We could change gain. I mean, just boost it up or down. Fade in or fade out. We can make this silent. We can invert it, which means anytime a waveform is going up and then down, it would go down then up instead. We can reverse it. This is cool for doing reverse cymbals and that kind of thing. We can trim it, so cut off the excess, and we can remove DC offset. DC offset is a result of the waveform's average center level being pushed up or down, usually due to a super low frequency sound that's summed with this, and it creates problems. Typically, this happens with poor equipment or non-professional gear that's not designed properly. We can also open some settings here for some fades and normalization. So this tells us what to normalize to and how the fades should look. And those refer to this normalize and to these fades. And then we can adjust tempo by selection and locators, search peaks, and search silence. So search peaks, for instance, is going to tell us if there's any peaks in our program material here, which it doesn't look like there is at this point. Okay, so that's a good place to break. We'll continue on with this in part 2.